Remember field trips and first dates? Generations have come to the Exploratorium to learn and play. Now we need your help, and every dollar you donate will be doubled. Sustain the wonder.
Welcome to the Exploratorium. This is Storytime Science. I'm Viv, and today's episode is Fluid Motion, Wind. We're going to be reading Gust, Gust, Gust by Ray Jaramillo. So the reason this book is called Gust, Gust, Gust is because the main character is named Gustavo, but the word gust also means a little bit of wind that whips by. And this book is not only written by Ray Jaramillo, he also did the artwork. I love the way it starts. Once upon a time, there was a little boy who loved to play the bongos. His name was Gustavo, but in his village, everyone called him Gust. The bongos were special to Gust because his tata, that's his grandfather, taught him how to play when he was a little boy. When Gust was a baby and the wind began to whirl, Gust's tata would play the bongos to comfort him and help him fall asleep. In this village, they relied on wind to power their windmills, which supplied the electricity and pumped the water to the entire village. The wind was a necessity to Gust's village. One evening, a storm rolled in, and the wind began to howl. Gust was afraid of the wind and asked his tata if he would play the bongos. As Gust and his tata were playing the bongos in the town square, the storm grew fierce. The wind made the houses rattle, trees tumbled down, and debris twirled in the air. It seemed as if every time the wind blew, the villagers heard the bongos playing. The villagers were fed up and blamed the destruction from the wind on Gust and his tata playing the bongos. The villagers forbid them from ever playing the bongos again. Ooh, they thought they made the wind so strong. Gust was sad, and that night he wished upon a star that the wind would disappear and never come back to his village again. From that day forward, the wind never blew in the village again. Soon, the village began to suffer. Without the wind that powered the windmills, the village would soon be without electricity and water. The village elders were concerned when they realized the wind had disappeared. The village elders called an emergency meeting. When Tata told Gust about the emergency meeting and the concerns of the village elders, Gust admitted to his Tata that he was the one who wished that the wind would disappear and never come back. Tata told the village elders about Gust's wish. Later that evening, the village elders asked Gust if he could play his bongos once more in hopes the wind would come back. Gust was so excited at the chance to play the bongos again. He ran across the village, got his tata and their bongos, and headed to the town square. Almost instantly, as they started to play, the wind began to whirl. The windmill's blades began to turn, and very soon, the town had electricity and water again. The villagers were so excited. They lifted Gust and his tata on their shoulders and told them never to stop playing their bongos again. And they all cheered, "Gust, Gust, Gust." Have you ever seen a windmill? And here's a picture of modern day windmills, which are called turbines. It's nice, clean power. Gustavo lives in a village that's powered by windmills, and we're not going to make a big old windmill, but we are going to make a pinwheel. I made one here, and so for this we need cardstock, which is a little bit thicker than regular paper, but it's not as thick as cardboard. And I have a piece of cardstock right here, and I measured, I like to measure for this using a ruler because it's a very, very handy tool to have. I measured a square that is 5 inches by 5 inches. And then I measured across to find the center. So it's 5 inches by 5 inches, but across on the diagonal, it was 7 inches. And I knew that half of 7 is 3.5. So I measured to 3.5 and I got the center right there, and I made a pencil mark right there on the center. It doesn't have to be exact. It doesn't have to be perfect. And I also, when I start cutting the individual, spokes, I guess we can call them, or little wings of the pinwheel, I don't want to cut all the way into the middle so they won't be too floppy. So I just have a cup, a paper cup, and I'm going to put it, approximately in the middle. And I'm just going to draw a line around it so I know when to stop when I do my cuts. All right, so again, doesn't have to be perfect. In fact, it wasn't perfect, but that's all right. I'm going to do it anyway. And now I'm going to cut out that square. And maybe you can even hear that because I'm cutting cardstock and not paper, it's a little bit thicker. Okay, now I have my square. And I'm going to make 4 cuts into the square of paper, and I'm going to make them from the 4 points. I'm going to make them on the diagonal. And remember, I'm not going to cut all the way in to the dot in the center. All right? And I'm going to go ahead and use my ruler and mark this with a pencil as well, just so I make sure I'm as close to perfect as I can be. Perfection is not necessary. Ooh, I didn't make a very, very dark line with my pencil. What is my problem? There we go, much better. So you can see I made 1 line from the corner, not quite to the middle point, just kind of sort of to the middle point. And I'm going to do another one from the other corner and make sure that my ruler is not sliding around too much. And this is 3. And getting in the corner there, and 4. Okay, so now I have my 4 lines coming in from the points. I'm going to cut those. 1. And again, I am not cutting all the way to the middle because we don't want them to be too floppy. And 2. And 3. I bet you know what's going to come next. 4. And now we're going to fold so that they catch the wind that you're going to make when you blow on them. And the best way to fold these is to take a point and then just go along that line. So let me go ahead and make a fold and then I'll show you. So I made 1 fold and I folded it so that this edge right here, right there, lines up exactly with that edge right there. And I'm going to do that 4 times. Go around to each one. And this just makes a nice, clean-looking pinwheel. Very cool. I like these. You may have even made one of these before. Does yours power a whole village? All right, so then here we are. We have, I'm gonna unfold them just a little bit so that they're gonna catch the wind really well. And now, this is something you might want an adult assistance for, a grown-up assistant. Remember, grown-ups make the best assistants. So I have a pushpin. You can also use a thumbtack. And they're pointy. And, you know, the potential for an owie is there. So I'm going to take a paper straw. I think I'll take yellow. And I'm going to poke a hole into the paper straw. And this is a nice sturdy hole there. It's really hugging that pushpin. And I pull the pushpin out. Now, we do want this to be nice and loose the way it's holding the paper. So now we want to poke that pushpin through that center hole, but we want that center hole to be a little bit bigger than the pushpin. So I'm going to poke this hole in there, and I'm going to move it around a little bit. Maybe I'm going to poke it in twice or even three times and just move it around so that that hole right in the middle of our paper here is a little bit bigger than the pushpin. All right, that's going to mean it's loose enough to really roll around. And now I am going to put the pushpin through this piece of paper, our little wings, and then through the nice sturdy hole that we made in the straw. Now, I'm going to test it out. Works really well. But you have that very, very pokey end of the pin coming out the back of the straw. What I'm going to do is I want to give it a little bit of a cushion. And I'm going to do that by cutting the eraser off of a pencil. And then we have a little eraser part. And I'm going to put it on the table. And I'm going to, actually, I'm not going to put it on the table. I'm just going to hold it up. This is why you might need an adult assistant. And I am just going to smush that onto the end of the push pin so that you won't get poked by that little pointy tip of the push pin. Hopefully, I didn't push so hard that this thing is still flowing. Let's see. Looks good. All right, let's give it a try. See, you can see that it's cushioned on the back so you won't poke your finger. And wind or air is something they call a fluid. Now, sometimes you hear grown-ups talk about fluids, and it might mean something that's wet, like a liquid, like water or juice or something like the ocean. But a fluid can be a gas, like air, or it can be a liquid, like water. A fluid can be either of those things, and it just means something that's constantly moving and it doesn't have a fixed shape and it's not bordered by something. And air is, even if it's not windy, air is always flowing all around you. And if you think of the ocean or even the water in your bathtub, the water is not still. It's not a block of ice. It is moving very, very slowly, sometimes so that you can't even see it or notice it. But here you have a pinwheel, and you can make it go forward. You can make it go backwards. Nice, handy little thing that, I don't know, you could build a ton of these and maybe power your village. Time for Poetry Corner. I wrote some haikus, and remember that a haiku is a counting poem. So the first line has 5 syllables or word sounds, and the second line has 7 syllables or word sounds, and the third line has 5 syllables. Okay? The first one is about our main character. The strong wind whips through. Gustavo plays the bongos. Can he save the town? The wind is blowing. The air is swirling around. I can feel the breeze. Invisible wind, and yet I know you are there. You move leaves, flags, hair. Wind is energy. It transforms into power, electricity. A fluid means that something is always moving. It might not be wet.